1. The world is everything that is the case. 1.1. The world is the totality of facts, not of things. 1.11. The world is determined by the facts, and bodies being all the facts. 1.12. For the totality of facts determines both what is the case, and also all that is not the case. 1.13. The facts in logical space are the world. 1.2. The world divides into facts. 1.21. Anyone can either be the case or not be the case, and everything else remains the same. That, of course, is the entire first chapter of Ludwig Wittgenstein's Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus, with its proposition that we might begin with the metaphysics of relations rather than objects. The world is the totality of facts, not of things. Where facts, for Wittgenstein, are states of affairs, but those relations, those states of affairs, are composed in turn of dispositions of objects. So I want to start from this perspective, this particular world, and see what happens when we think about the facticity of objects, or, in other words, when we try to think objectively about facts, states of affairs. Is there a point at which these terms can be collapsed in that way, can be mise en abyme, so that we can take facts as the ground for assessing the facts on the ground? Now one point, of course, at which the Tractatus falls into the self-reflexive tautologies it tries to banish from the philosophically meaningful is at the moment one recognizes language as material, or words as objects. This will be one of the lessons of those avant-gardes that the aristocratic classicist Wittgenstein personally disdained. If we recognize words as material objects, then there are states of affairs that obtain under the disposition of words as well as other objects, and the Tractatus itself, fortuitously, gives us the opportunity to understand the implications of a linguistic factist. At 2.012, Wittgenstein asserts, in logic, nothing is accidental, in der Logik ist nichts Zufall. But the accidental is precisely what we find when the world is everything that is the case. Die Welt ist alles, was der Fall ist. By chance, Zufall, in German, chance, accident, coincidence, the case, der Fall, is always inscribed in the accidental, Zufallig, not to mention der Fall, a trap, a snare, like Marcel Duchamp's Trebuchet, a stumbler, something that trips one up, that might lead one to fall, fallen, in German. And remembering all the while that the English word chance, by sheer coincidence, with no etymological connection to the German at all, descends to us from the Latin sedere, to fall.
And I think, I don't know, but this is a difficult position because I've been in it all the time and still want to get rid of it.
Chance and falling are independently linked. So a coincidence about coincidence, where coincidence of course, comes, again, etymologically, from a falling in together, coincidere. Now Wittgenstein could have used other words. Anyone text, say, can either be the case or not be the case, and everything else remains the same. But the point is that he didn't. Which is precisely one of the lessons the Tractatus discusses, as well as enacts. It's not that the world couldn't have been otherwise, that it can't be different, but that, for the moment, it's not. And that realization, at least in its complement, prefigures the political stakes inherent in this material, if not materialist, philosophy. Otro mundo es posible. Another world is always possible, and always imminent in the case, in the world as it happens, by chance, to be. Back in the mid-90s, in another world, I'd been working for some time on a series of projects that conflated form and content in various ways. So for instance, a manual for mid-century office workers on how to file alphabetically, which I alphabetized according to its own system, or a book on vivisection which I dissected with a scalpel and reprinted on vellum, or a 19th century grammar book which I parsed according to its own system, and so on. The whimsical aspect of these projects was coming out of an interest in surrealism and in pataphysics. And their theoretical aspect was coming out of a literary critical interest in radical formalism, a politicized insistence on form as a mode of information in its own right, as a kind of content. as well as a curiosity about what might constitute realism as an ethos rather than merely an historical style or rhetorical stance. At the same time, I'd begun investigating conceptual art. This was a time before it had been recovered by any of the big art history reference books. It was still being slighted by the October group, and so on. So there was lots of work to be done, and I had been looking specifically into self-reflexive works like Mel Ramsden's late 60s series of 100% abstract paintings, which used paint to write out texts that offered information about the paint itself. So for instance, copper bronze powder 12%, acrylic resin 7%, aromatic hydrocarbons 81%, or as another canvas read, titanium calcium 83%, silicate 17%, and so on. That latter being a kind of inside painter's joke, or comment on the anti-retinal mandate of conceptual art, since the chemicals named calcium sulfate with a whitening agent of titanium dioxide and various silicate extenders, titanium calcium 83%, silicate 17%, indicate the acrylic gesso primer invisible beneath the painted text but an essential part of the substrate of the painting that makes that text legible. I had also been tracking the various permutations of Dan Graham's mid-60s poem schema, which you can see in the exhibition here and which is similarly self-reflexive, providing a template or interface which structures an enumeration of the physical and grammatical properties of its own particular printed instantiation. How many nouns, how many capital letters, what type of paper, etc. As Graham explained it, quote, a page of schema exists as a matter of fact materiality. It is a measure of itself, as place. It takes its own measure, of itself as place, that is, place two-dimensionally on, as a page. Unquote. In other words, a rhetorically matter-of-fact report on the matter of facts, where the facts are all about matter, materiality. So about a decade ago these various interests came together in a poem titled, Realism, which I thought would be the easiest poem I had ever written. For some reason, I thought the toner cartridge in the photocopier would have ingredients just listed on the label, like packaged food, and that I would just copy it down and then Xerox that text in Biola, Realism. But of course all that information was proprietary, so instead of a few minutes, it took over a year, requesting stock reports and tracing supply lists to import manifests of chemical safety data sheets, searching for patents and data some chemicals, built a lot of reverse engineering and corporate detective work. With the result,
22nd of October 38, Astoria. This was the first photocopy.
After that, I went on to do the same thing for a variety of different media, what bibliographers would call different editions of the same work, all under the uniform title Fact. So in addition to the piece for photostatic copier, versions for the particular papers and inks in several different books and magazines, there's a version in the Venerable Poetry magazine, which I think is very funny, vinyl printed plastic, a kind of lucite-like sculpture, an audio version for CDR, the 16mm film that is screening here, there is another for data projection on view in a gallery in Leeds at the moment, etc. And back around the turn of the millennium, I'd been planning an online version, but then computer screen technology suddenly expanded and exploded before I could finish it, with new types of plasma and touchscreens and so on. And there were simply too many variables to make it practical. So the solution, I think, ultimately, is to team with a neuroscientist to work out the precise chemical reactions that take place in the brain when reading, so that the medium of the text would no longer matter for its factual status. In that sense, it would be true no matter what one were reading, or whatever matter, it wouldn't matter. I think that's the one thing that will free me from the endless proliferation of these projects. But first, I have two versions in progress to finish, a billboard for Toronto's power plant, to coincide with the postscript installation there, and the floor rug, for Simon Morris, an artist whose work you can see upstairs. The rug is a funny story, actually. Simon had a moving allowance from his university, when he took a new job last year, but it could only be spent on textiles, and there were only so many curtains he could buy. So he had thousands of pounds left to spend, and set me up with Bizarre Velvet, London's premier luxury carpet designer, who was making a bespoke rug for us. I got to handpick the sheep that would supply the wool. The cute little Tibetan merinos are actually being sheared this week, and I got to specify the dyes and so on. And then of course, even working with the rug makers, I've had to read a half dozen books on wool chemistry. I tracked down Indian pigment suppliers, and researched wonderful British terms to meet here like color palms and glaur salts, not to SO4 sodium sulfate and so on. These are poems in their own right. I've had Simon promise to make people wipe their boots before they walk all over it. So the whole thing has returned to the absurdist origins of the project. But for all the whimsy and absurdity and, I hope, humor of these works, there's a very serious politics to them as well, and it's worth remembering that Wittgenstein's metaphysics ends with an ethics. And I take the ethics, the politics of facts, that is, facts in his logical sense any facts as the titles of these works to be twofold. On the one hand, the practically illegible or meaningless nature of these texts, the way in which increasing their data decreases the information absorbable by the reader, at least the average non-chemist reader, and the way in which even fundamentally different objects start to sound more and more alike the closer one analyzes their chemistry, both point toward one of the laws of media. That we should think of media not so much as objects, but rather as social relations between people, which is to say, political relations.
You're a very bad man.
Media only became legible in social contexts because they are not things, but rather activities. Commercial, communicative, and, fundamentally, interpretive. So when Seth Kim Cohen hands me a blank CD and tells me it's the latest non-cochlear release by Jarrod Fowler, it's quite different than if the clerk at Office Depot hands me a bank CD and wants money in return, even though they're identical objects. Hydrophobic solid eye resin sheets varnished to 5 micrometer thick acrylic lamina, epoxy polymer, methyl acrylic acid, C18H3204, and benzophenone, C13H100, spin coat lacquer to an encodus gain group 0.067 micrometer thick follicle of gold, sputtered to aeronitrogen stabilized cyanine, CHCHCHN, dyed to a 1.2 mm thick center punch clear polycarbonate substrate, C16H1403. Just to set the facts straight. So media, I want to argue, are aptly named not so much because they bear messages between writers and readers, or because they communicate an artist's ideas, but because they negotiate our socially mediated experience, including our experience of physical objects. On the other hand, the politics of states of affairs, that disposition of objects in the world, can be glimpsed in the chemical record, in the facts of the matter. The molecular array betrays a whole host of grosser events, so that the physical facts of these objects can be read as symptoms of larger structures. Take, for just the first instance, ink on an 8.5x11 inch, right away, without reading anything more, the trim size of the substrate betrays whole histories. It indicates a standard US letter size, obviously, in comparison with an A4 sheet, say, which is 8.27 x 11.69 inches, a 3.1763 square inch difference, an almost inference difference, but one that suggests much larger issues. A4, like the entire a series of trims, is based on the square root of 2, basically, paper cut in half is similar to itself, so there are scalable dimensions. This was a popular late 18th century math problem, with the connotations of reason in rational relations and in neoclassical aesthetics of symmetrical harmonies. The idea for this kind of trim standard goes back to Georg Lichtenberg, who, incidentally, pioneered the investigations into electrostatic phenomenon that led directly to the photocopier for which the A4 type paper sizing he proposed is perfectly suited, since its scalable ratios allow for things like the perfect fit of 2 open book pages reduced to a single sheet, something US letter size can't do. 9. Though the A4 comes down to us, indirectly, via the 1922 German DIN 476, Deutsches Institut für Norm und Directive Number 476, Prussian Efficiency and Industrialization, adopted as ISO 216, 8.27 x 11.69 inches, 210 mm, 297 mm, becomes the office norm everywhere after World War II except in the US and Canada and Mexico. Though they have a complicated partial adoption there, but basically everywhere except North America. So that 3.1763 square inch difference raises questions of standardization and globalization, issues of nationalism and histories of empire and colonization. It manifests the forms of international corporate bureaucracy taken by capital in the 20th century, and it reminds us of the ideology of the seemingly natural size of a page, and so on. Similar histories are recoverable from the chemical makeup of each of those 0.375 inch cubed volumes of paper and ink. As filmmaker Hollis Frampton said in The Invention Without a Future, his 1979 Whitney lecture, quote, not only are Xeroxes made out of paper and a little bit of hydrocarbon, but worse, nothing much more than pigmented paraffin, and bad paper at that, unquote. Frampton, in this talk, is trying to make visible the hidden social histories of aesthetics. He explains, quote, if the Romans had not practiced slavery in Spain, the sulfide of mercury called cinnabar would never have been found in quantity in the Mediterranean, and thus certain reds that we treasure in the painting of the Renaissance would not be around to this day. Unquote. And though he doesn't quite say this, the implications I think are clear and interesting. One could look at a 15th century biblical painting of the flight from Egypt and be looking simultaneously at a depiction of slavery and material byproduct of slavery, the figures represented on the panel unable to escape the economic conditions that make their representation possible in the first place and which accounts for the value that kept the work preserved for us to see it. Frampton is also arguing for the hidden, congealed cost of the work of art. Quote, in an economic environment that tends to demand that nothing can be printed unless you print 100,000 copies of it, whole forests fell for Saul Bellow to become a Nobel laureate. For example, vast tracts in Idaho were the raft that floated Mr. Bellow to Sweden on that occasion. Unquote. Moreover, more proximate and directly relevant for the addition of fact on display here, he explains, quote, old film support, cellulose nitrate, was military fallout, it was gun cotton. Very simply, a large manufacturing technology existed to produce the stuff in quantity. The flexibility and transparency of the stuff were what was at issue in this case, not its explosiveness, but that has continued to be a problem. Nitrate, as we know, still undergoes slow motion explosion, and 19th century military technology is, after all, working its revenge upon the early cinema silently in millions of dark tin cans all over the West. Unquote. Now again, Frampton doesn't propose this explicitly, but I want to follow his thinking through a bit and suggest that watching a battle scene in some Civil War costume drama is thus watching the history of cinema itself, and in the case of something like Birth of a Nation, watching the film itself, the future of the substrate sped up over years and compressed into every rifle shot. So you have a certain lyric collapse of theme and content like the other, more austere and less figurative works I describe. Frampton continues, quote, the emulsifying or suspending agent is gelatin. The Eastman Kodak Company still insists that the very best photographic gelatin is made from selected ear and cheek clippings of Argentinian beef cattle that are fed on mustard greens. But that gelatin could only become available in quantity after a specific economic moment had been reached in the West. That was the development of vast latifundia for the raising of beef cattle in the western United States and in the Argentine. The gelatin was, again, a fallout from a process of exploitation of an entirely different kind. And finally there was the brief moment during which the photographic industries fastened upon silver alloy technology as the material basis of the image. It could have settled on other salts and metals, which proceeded also from an unusual circumstance, and that was the great silver strikes of the 1870s and 80s in Colorado, right here and in Idaho, which released vast quantities of that element into the market within the period of a decade. The total quantity of silver in the world increased by something like 3 decimal orders of magnitude. Unquote. And just to put this in perspective, the amounts of silver in film are small, but not incidental. 35mm uses 2-3 grams of silver a minute. That's worth about $150 a minute at current prices. Frampton concludes, quote, nevertheless, it had always been rare. It was made available again, briefly and in quantity, through a process of real estate exploitation. Unquote. Now again, Frampton doesn't pursue the thematic implications of this, one of which is how resonant the persistent genre of the Western becomes. So all the narratives about conflicts between miners and cowboys and ranchers were not just adventure stories, but the story of the substrate of film itself, the story of the history cinema itself. Watching the cattle stampede in Red River, say, the 1948 film with John Wayne and Montgomery Clift, or the cattle roundup as a set piece in any number of westerns, is watching those cows and steers with a kind of double vision, the images of cattle depicted by the exposed film and the bovine gelatin that makes those images visible. And this situation of course obtains for all material and media. In a very interesting article on labor in the video game The Sims, Mackenzie Work notes that computer processors, video game consoles, personal computers, rely on semiconductors which rely on tantalum, a very good conductor of heat and electricity. Work explains, quote, the tantalum was quite possibly refined from coltan, short for columbite tantalite, dug out of the ground in the Congo, which has plenty. The Okapi Reserve in the Congo is home to gorillas, monkeys, and elephants, as well as the okapi, a rare relative of the giraffe. Thousands of mbudi, or pygmies, also live there. Their livelihood is compromised by the coltan miners, who dig what one journalist called SUV-sized holes in the mud, out of which they can extract about a kilo of coltan a day. A kilo of coltan was worth $80 during the tech boom. There was a world shortage of the stuff, which even delayed the release of the Sony PlayStation 2. Unquote. Wark's point is that the abstracted, detached, cleanly virtual world of game space is implicated in the global logistics that make modern corporate capital function, and that the clean, well-lit, rule-bound space of the video game is inextricably bound to a very dirty, literally muddy, ugly, material world. And I want to again push those insights and reminders about the facts of media back toward narrative content. So someone playing an Xbox shooter about African mercenaries is reenacting the sorts of very real violence that the sale of coltan funded in the civil war that followed the collapse of the Mobutu Sese Seko regime in the Congo. The virtual landscape is produced by the tangible geographic landscape it represents. There is, in fact, by chance, an old Mac computer game titled Congo, the ultimate first-person jungle adventure. As a special operative for the TRAVICOM conglomerate, venture deep into the unexplored Congo on a quest for rare diamonds hidden within the legendary city of Zinj. Astonishing special effects and 3D graphics plunge you headlong into this deadly gauntlet. Experience exotic jungles, raging rivers, subterranean caves, active volcanoes and deadly adversaries. Armed with an arsenal of high-tech devices, you must rely on strategy, quick thinking and puzzle-solving skills to survive. Hang on for an unforgettable adventure where you are the endangered species. And those endangered species come back in games like Zoo Tycoon, where you can conserve animated representations of the very animals, gorillas, giraffes, elephants, that are killed and endangered by the very game you are playing. So there is a sickening irony that the materials displacing certain species, the traces of elements and minerals displaced to your microprocessors, permit those animals to return, as ghostly virtual images, in a simulacrum of the zoo that might have saved them. So that in that revenant sense, the violence of the adventure game Congo, or the exile gorillas in Zoo Tycoon, are merely the narrative versions, however cliched or cartoonish, of what you look at every time you turn on your computer.